Hey everyone, I'm Samantha Rank with the Daily Caller, and joining me today is Daniel DiMartino, a Venezuelan native and research associate at the Institute for the Study of Free Enterprise. Daniel, thanks for joining me.
Thanks, Sam.
Unfortunately, your grandfather recently passed away from COVID-19 in Spain. Before we talk more about his battle with coronavirus, could you just talk a little bit about who he was as a person and your relationship with him?
Yes. So my grandfather was born in Spain in 1936. That's the year that the Civil War started in Spain. And he was left orphan during the Civil War. And he was the only son of his father. Then his mother remarried. She had, you know, many more children. And he was the older brother in the family, the man of the house. You know, that's how he felt as well. And He started working from a very young age. He actually had to drop out of school to work in a candy factory. And he has so many stories. And he worked there for many years, you know, trying to provide for his family. But Spain was not in a good economic state back then in the 30s, in the 40s, or even the 1950s. So he emigrated to Venezuela eventually when he was just 19 years old. And when he went to Venezuela, he started sending money back to his family in Spain. He married my grandmother. He had my mom. And I've always looked up to him because he has a story of personal struggle. And even though he didn't have a formal education, he made, you know, so many things in life.
He started to feel ill around March 27th. So can you just talk about that timeline of when he first started experiencing symptoms to when he passed away?
Yes. And well, another thing also that I wanted to say about him was, you know, he had left Spain in 1956 and he ended up going back to Spain just 2 years ago because of what's going on in Venezuela with socialism. And it's very sad that the reason that he passed away was in large part because of socialist policies that led to this. So he started feeling ill in late March. I can't remember the exact day now, but he had been ill for several days, just like my parents and my grandmother. That he had all the symptoms, fever, cough, he was shaking. And when you call the doctors, when my mom called the doctors, they, you know, told her that, you know, they can't do anything. They can't even give him a prescription or anything. It's obviously this is a new virus. There's no treatment, but he can't be admitted to the hospital to get hospitalized or get oxygen unless he stops breathing. So that day came and it was Friday. I think that was the Friday, March 27th. And that night, it was actually just after I had called my family to see how they were before they went to sleep. And my mom called me back after that and told me that he had been rushed to the hospital. They took him to a private hospital, the one that my parents had always gone to, and my grandparents as well, and they didn't admit him. And the reason was that 2 weeks before, and I found that out the day my granddad went, the Spanish government had taken over private clinics. They had nationalized them with the excuse of, you know, the coronavirus crisis, which in other words meant that if you have private insurance, if you have a deal with the clinic, then you can't get the services that you were promised. So all that was, you know, for a waste. Exactly when you need your insurance is when they took it over. So they took him to a public hospital. And I was very concerned because, you know, my other grandparents from my dad's side live in Italy. Thankfully, they're healthy. And they had read the news that, you know, many old people were being left to die in Italy because the hospital systems in European countries, because they're single payer systems, the government cut spending, therefore they cut investment in healthcare. There are no hospital beds for everybody. So how are they going to ration hospital beds? And they ration them by letting the old people die. It's unfortunate. And then on Sunday, the doctor called my mom. And the doctor told her that, you know, if my grandfather needed an ICU, then he, you know, wouldn't be getting one because he was over 65. I unfortunately heard the next day that my grandfather passed away. with pneumonia caused by coronavirus. And all his life, he never had been to the hospital for anything. He never even had an accident, never smoked, never did anything. He was old, true, but he deserved a chance. And I think that an ICU, a ventilator, something that, you know, people here in the United States are not lacking, that would have given him a chance, and that would have made me feel better.
Just to talk about coronavirus more generally, the Associated Press recently reported that China knew about of a likely pandemic for about 6 days and didn't warn the public. What are your reactions to this news, and how do you think China should be, if they should be held accountable?
China needs to be held accountable. You know, there are many reports that it is from Wuhan government labs that the virus came from. Whether it was by accident or not, this is a government institution in China, and therefore the government of China is liable, the Chinese Communist Party. And in addition to it coming from that source, then they hid all this information, then they weaponized the World Health Organization to also supposedly calm down concerns of the virus. And everybody believed them for a while, and that delayed the virus response in the United States, in Europe, everywhere else. So not only is socialized medicine to blame for my grandfather's death, it's also the Chinese Communist regime. And you know, I've always been an advocate against socialism and against totalitarianism, against government intervention in the economy, but I never thought that it would hit me this hard and this close to home as it did 2 weeks ago.
Do you agree with President Trump's plans to defund the World Health Organization?
100% I agree with that. We cannot, as the United States, fund an organization that is not doing its job. They did not do their job with coronavirus. And not only are they not doing their job, but they're being used as a political weapon to further the interests of China. And, you know, they exclude Taiwan as a member of the organization. When the members of the World Health Organization Executive Committee are asked about Taiwan, they don't even want to answer. It's complete censorship. We cannot, as taxpayers, fund an organization that goes against our interests.
And just to wrap up the interview, so obviously we talked a lot about socialism and socialized healthcare. That is a huge issue moving forward with the 2020 election here in the United States. What's your message to candidates that are pushing for more socialist-like policies and agendas?
I think that the coronavirus crisis has proved how superior America's healthcare system is in combating diseases in times of crisis. No system is perfect. America's system is not perfect and needs a lot of improvement. It has a lot of interventions that make it inefficient and life harder for everyone. But we have more ICU beds and more ventilators adjusted for our population than any other country in the world. And that's what's saving lives in the coronavirus pandemic. And that's what's killing many people in Europe, which the Democrats, the radical Democrats, held their systems. Look at what's happening there versus what's happening here. So I'm very thankful to be living in America.